often forfeit because we do not carry everything.
Lord, what peace we often forfeit.
You're God of peace.
Because we do not carry everything to you in prayer. You're the God of peace.
That doesn't know that, that hasn't experienced.
Lord, I pray that today,
you can give.
If there's somebody in the room,
God, today would be that, day.
That doesn't know that, that hasn't experienced,
Lord,
the peace that only you can give,
there's somebody here that,
that God,
really
today would be that
to
day.
Some of these things we've been seeing today.
Lord, maybe as a believer in this room, there's somebody here that is just really struggling to believe some of these things we've been seeing today. But Lord, I pray today you would encourage their heart. Lord, they would know that you are everything your word says you are. You are everything we've sung about this morning. And so much more, God. We can't put words to who you are. There is no one like you. There is none beside you.
We ask you to do a work in us.
And so today, God, we just open our hearts and we open our minds and we ask you to do a work in us. Lord, I pray for every single person in the room this morning. That God, their heart would be open to you. And God, what you want to speak for Pastor Roger today.
Just ask you to use it today in a mighty way.
God, it would be impactful for their life. And Lord, we lift Roger to you as he comes and just ask you to use him today in a mighty way for your glory and your fame. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Everybody said,
amen. Good stuff. Appreciate that worship team, don't you? That was awesome. I appreciate it. Awesome. It's good to see you. I appreciate the group. A lot went into getting everything ready for this week. And I know God is going to do some amazing things. I want to start off today. If you have your Bible, I want to encourage you to turn to 1 Samuel and always kind of parallel your Bible. We'll have the scriptures up on the screen. But it's always good to check it out and just kind of look at your translation as well. And also, if you did get a bulletin inside, there should be some notes. I want to encourage you to fill in some blanks. I want to start off with just kind of a mind stretcher today and kind of just kind of run by the top five most mentioned people in the Bible. And I went ahead and gave you number one because I know that's what you would have guessed, all right? So Jesus is obviously the most mentioned individual in the Bible, but we'll start at the bottom. Number five, the fifth person mentioned most often in the Bible is Jacob. All right, he's mentioned 358 times. Number four is Saul. We're going to be talking a little bit about Saul today. Number three, Moses. And the second person mentioned most often in the Bible, other than Jesus, David. All right, and so David is mentioned 1,127 times, 59 times in the New Testament, and 64 chapters are given to the life of David. That's amazing when you think about it. And to show you how amazing that is, Abraham, there are 15 chapters given to the life of Abraham, and we know how important he is. I believe Joseph has about 15 chapters, Elijah about 10 chapters, but David, 64 chapters in the Bible, mentioned more than any other person other than Jesus. There's something about the life of David God does not want us to miss. And so we're going to be looking today at the life of David. And so this summer we've been taking kind of a road trip. If you remember, the first part of the summer we talked about our individual prayer life. And the last part of the summer we're going to be talking about praise. And we're going to be focused in the book of Psalms. And Psalms, if you remember, was the Hebrew songbook. If you remember from last week, the Hebrew word for Psalms means praises, and the Greek word, when they translated the Hebrew to Greek about 3 centuries BC, they used a word that means the plucking of strings. And so the book of Psalms is really a hymn book meant to be sung with instruments. And it really is an amazing book of worship. And it's probably not an accident that Psalms is in the very middle of our Bible. As a matter of fact, maybe the easiest book to find, if you take your Bible and open it in the very middle, you should be in the book of Psalms. It's not only in the heart of our scripture, I think it's in the heart of God, learning how to worship. And as I shared last week, worship was here before the creation account in the book of Genesis. The angels were worshiping God. And long after this world is here, and when we're spending an eternity with God, we're going to forever worship God. And so worship is so important. And as I mentioned last week, as far as I know in heaven, there's going to be no preaching. How many of you say amen to that? I mean, we've probably been through enough down here, even got one body clapping on the front row, all right? So that's good. So this morning, I just want to look at the life of David. What was it about David that God would give so much time in Scripture to? What was it about him, about his life, about him? And the Bible says, actually, David referred to himself in 2 Samuel 23 as he was given kind of his final words. He referred to himself as the anointed of God, the sweet psalmist of Israel. And so if the book of Psalms is a book of worship, and David is considered the sweet psalmist of Israel, there's something about the heart of David. There's something about worship that we can all learn from David. David wrote 73 of the Psalms, has his name ascribed over them. But we know in the New Testament there are two more Psalms. Luke says in Acts chapter 4 that he wrote one of the Psalms. And also in Hebrews chapter 4, the writer of Hebrews says that he wrote Psalms 95. He quotes David. So we know that David wrote at least half of the Psalms. And so these songs of worship were written from the heart of David, who again, the Bible talks about more than anybody else in the Bible other than Jesus. And so we're going to look at David this morning. You remember when Samuel spoke to Saul and God knew that he was going to have to get a new king. And so let's read together the yellow print as Samuel is speaking to Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 13. Let's read together. Your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought for himself a man after his own heart. And so God said to Saul through Samuel, God is looking for someone after his own heart. You know, man looks for a Superman king. We look for somebody who's incredibly gifted and talented. The one requirement God was looking for was a heart after his. And I want to say this morning that, you know, as we worship together, I believe we can. It's possible to worship loud. It's possible to jump up and down. It's possible to bow down and weep. But the one thing God is looking for is a loyal heart. You know, in 2 Chronicles, it says the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth. God is looking for someone with a loyal heart. And so here, and also in the book of Acts, when Paul was preaching in Antioch, he also referred to David as a man after God's own heart. Now, in one way, that surprises us because we all know that David committed some pretty grievous sin, if we're being honest. I mean, if I'm being honest, I would almost say that David committed more grievous sin than Saul did. I mean, Saul was certainly disobedient, but can we be honest? David committed open adultery with Bathsheba. He had her husband Uriah killed. And then later, he numbered the children of Israel, if you remember. And when God pointed it out, as a result of him numbering the children of Israel, he says, I have sinned greatly. And the Bible says God's 70,000 Israelites died as a result of his pride. Can you imagine 70,000 people died because of the pride of his heart? How could God say he was a man after my own heart? It wasn't that he was perfect. But here's the difference between, or a couple differences between David and Saul. When Saul was pointed out that he had sinned, he made excuses. He began to say, well, it wasn't me. The people, they kind of swayed me. Saul never was broken over his sin. But when David sinned and God pointed it out, he was broken. I want to tell you, it's not that we're going to live a perfect life, but I want to tell you, when our heart is after God's heart, it'll break when his heart breaks. And so I'm not saying that God's looking for anybody perfect, but he's looking for someone with a heart that will beat after his heart. And so let's think about the life of David for a minute. He had a very humble beginning. If some of you think that you had a humble beginning, I think we can learn from David. The Bible says that God sent Samuel to Bethlehem, a town of about 300 people. It would be, if I were to rename Bethlehem, it would be Podunk Israel. How many of you came from a little bitty podunk town? All right. And you may say, well, it's just a little town. It's a nothing town. Let me say this. If God found David in Bethlehem, I just want to remind you that God knows exactly where you are. And so he's looking for a king. He sends Samuel to Bethlehem, a town of about 300, about 6 miles from Jerusalem. Now, there's a problem. If Samuel's going to anoint a king, there already is a king. You remember what Samuel said to God? He kind of talked with God. How many of you ever kind of discussed God's plan? And so he says to God, God, by the way, there already is a king. And if I go anoint another king, Saul is going to kill me. That's treason. I mean, you don't anoint another king when there still is a king. And if you can kind of read that discourse between Samuel and God, it's pretty cool. God says, well, take a heifer with you, say you're making a sacrifice. And it really is interesting how they work that out. And so he goes, and let's read together the red print here out of 1 Samuel 16, verse 1. The Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him? Fill your horn with oil and go to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided myself a king among his sons. And so he goes to this little podunk town. He goes to the house of Jesse, and he knows. And God gave him enough information. He didn't give him all the information, but God said, if you obey me this far, when you get there, I'll give you additional revelation. And let me just say this. Some of us want more revelation when we haven't obeyed what God has already told us to do. When we obey what God has told us to do, God will give us additional revelation. So he gets there. And so he gets to Jesse's house, and all of his sons begin to come out. You know the story. Starts with the oldest, and the Bible says, let's read together. Samuel looked at Eliab and said, surely this is the Lord's anointed. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his physical stature. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Can I tell you this morning, there's one thing God is looking at in each of our lives, and it's the heart. And I just, if we're going to be really honest and be kind of transparent, sometimes we focus more on the outward than we do on the inward. If I could give you an example, if I were to ask you how much mirror time you spent today, I know some of you that are in Team One International, you probably didn't get much mirror time. But how many of you, I don't know what the average is, but by the way, I'm glad you had some mirror time today, aren't you? They say there's no such thing as love at first sight before breakfast, all right? So the mirror is very important. But let me ask you this, and I don't want you to respond. But if we were to be honest today, I wonder how many of us spend a lot more time getting ready outwardly than we spent making sure our heart was right with God. God cares far more about the heart than he does about the outward appearance. And so one by one, all of Jesse's sons came before him. And one by one, God said, that's not the one. That's not the one. And then finally, Samuel says to Jesse, are all your sons here? And Jesse said, well, there is the one that doesn't really matter. I'm giving you my translation. Can you imagine Samuel, the prophet of Israel, comes to the house of Jesse, and he doesn't even bother allowing David to be there. He would have kept David out in the field. I mean, I'm being real. If the prophet was coming to my house, I would want all my family, my extended family, even some of my church family, I'd want you to be there. But they didn't even bother inviting David. How many of you are kind of on the low on the totem pole in your family? He was the youngest. How many of you know the youngest kids always get abused? I'm the youngest. Amen. That's why I say that. And so he says to Jesse, is this all your children? He says, well, there is the youngest. Now, it doesn't say, but I think he was saying, why bother? He said he's keeping the sheep. Now, if you know anything about shepherding over in that part of the, if you go over to Israel, there's still shepherds today. And by the way, it's not easy to find places for them to graze. You have to work to find something for them to eat and something for them to drink. Being a shepherd, a keeper of the sheep, was the lowest of the low responsibility in the family. It tells you what they thought of David. No one would want to be a keeper of the sheep. You had to stay out and live with the sheep, sleep with the sheep. And when you live with the sheep, you begin to smell like a sheep. And you, when you live with the sheep, you got to deal with all the weather issues. When it rains, you get wet. When it hails, you get beat on. And when you take care of the sheep, man, you got to stay with them. If one lamb goes astray, you got to go after it, bring it back. And not only that, at nighttime, you got to sleep with one eye open. Because at night, they can become a predator to other animals. And so you have to defend the sheep. And so you don't even really get a good night's rest. So he was living in Podunk, Bethlehem. He was the least of his father's house. He's out there keeping sheep. And it was almost like Jesse saying, well, we didn't even bother bringing him in. He's just keeping the sheep. Let me again say, no matter how low you feel like you are, God knows exactly where you're at. God knows exactly where you're at. And again, God is looking for somebody with a loyal heart. And I guess I didn't realize until studying the life of David how many times it refers to the fact that he was a keeper of the sheep. And so they bring David in, and the Bible says he was kind of ruddy looking, kind of a reddish complexion, kind of young. I don't know how old he was exactly. Josephus, a Jewish historian, says he was 10 years old. I don't know why he believes that. Many of the modern-day commentators put him at about 15 years old. And again, we don't know for sure, but let's just say 15. Here he comes in. He's 15 years old, and God says to Samuel, that's the one. But God, he smells like sheep. He didn't even fix himself. That's the one. And so the Bible says Samuel anointed David as king over Israel. Wow. And the Bible says all of his brothers were there. How many of you know that bothered his brothers? Oh, yeah. When they were all overlooked and they chose David and anointed David. And the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord came on David from that day forward. I want to tell you everything we know about David, man. The Spirit of God was on him. You know what he did after he got filled with the Spirit? He went back to the sheep. I want to tell you, if you're so spiritual that you can't be with sheep, you're too spiritual. By the way, it would be at least 15 years before he would actually become king, depending on what you believe his age was. He was 30 years old when he officially, finally became king over Judah. He wouldn't become king over Israel till he was 37 over all of Israel. Let me say this, when God puts his hand on your life, you have to be patient. How many of you are like me? I want God to do it today. I know God wants to use me. I want it to be today, please. But I want to tell you, it's in the back roads of life when nobody can see. When you're faithful doing what God's called you to do when nobody's around, that really is the character of your heart. You show me somebody who's loyal to God when nobody's looking, and I'll show you somebody that God is going to use. And by the way, the very next verse, which is the first verse of the next chapter, says the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. And when the Spirit of the Lord departs, and back in the Old Testament, the Spirit kind of came and went, because they weren't under the new covenant, but when the Spirit left Paul, he got agitated. How many of you have been around anybody agitated? Don't look at your spouse right now. And so they said to Saul, we need to find somebody to play some music. That'll make you feel better. And they heard about this young shepherd boy named David, and so they went to get David to come and play music for Saul. And guess where he was? When Saul sent to fetch David, he was with the sheep. I'll tell you something about the heart of David. He was willing to do the most menial task and serve God in the backwoods of life because that's what God had called him to do. And can I just say this? I wish that every seminary training ministers would take one semester and make us go out and shepherd, go out and live with the sheep. And I think if we can learn to love sheep and to just commit our life to sheep, it will help us learn to love God's people. And by the way, we're compared to sheep in the Bible. How many of you know that? All we like sheep have gone astray. And again, if you know anything about sheep, they're not the smartest animals on earth. If they get away from their home, they can't even find their way back to where to eat. That's bad. And so they sent and brought David and fetched him back, and he played music before the king. And I love when the Bible says in chapter 17, David would occasionally return to Bethlehem to check on his dad. No, it doesn't say that. Isn't it interesting that he would occasionally return to Bethlehem from the king's castle to feed his father's sheep? When you can really love the most menial task in life, and when you can honor God by serving him when nobody else is around, again, what a great tribute to God. So he had a heart to go back and feed his father's sheep. The classic chapter in David's life we think about is the story of David and Goliath in chapter 17. And so the Bible says Jesse sent David to bring supplies to his brother. And he was still a youth. Now, I want to be honest as a father. I cannot imagine sending my teenage son to the battlefield. I would go myself. But they sent little David to the battlefield to bring supplies to his brother. And when he gets there, here's the familiar scene. The Israel army is on one side. The Philistines are on the other side. And Goliath is in the valley taunting the God of Israel. He's taunting the Israelites. And I want to tell you, and even though it's a story we tell in children's church, and it's an awesome story and children's eyes bug out, it was far bigger than how we tell it. I want you to understand the history of the nation of Israel was at stake. Because here's what happened. If Goliath defeated the best soldier of Israel, they would kill all the men, they would rape all the women, and they would take all the children and make them slaves. I mean, the nation of Israel was in the balance. And here comes young David, who was just the keeper of the sheep. And he comes and he hears this Goliath taunting God, and it stirs his heart. And his older brother sees his younger brother stirred up. And how many of you know older brothers don't have much confidence in younger brothers? And so he sends him there, and Eliab, the oldest brother, was angry with David and said, listen to what Eliab said to David, why have you left those few sheep? Almost speaking down to David. You just had a few sheep. I love what it goes on to say. David says to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of Goliath. I will go and fight with this Philistine. All the Israeli army is there on the hill trembling. They look at Goliath and say, he's too big to hit. I think David looked at him and said, he's too big to miss. I want to tell you something else I know about David. He says, he goes on to say to Saul, when I kept my father's sheep and a lion or a bear would take a lamb, I would kill both the lion and the bear. Wow. That may not mean a lot to us that don't live around lions and bears, but if you've ever been to the zoo, and I've been Googling some lions, lions can stand as much as 4 foot tall on their shoulders, be 8 foot long, and weigh over 400 pounds, and they are solid muscle. They are the king of the beast of the field. Nobody messes with lions. Nobody preys on lions unless they're not too smart. But the Bible says, if you read the account, David would say, a lion would come and take a lamb, and I would go after it, and I would grab the lion by the beard. He's either totally drunk or filled with the Spirit. You don't grab a lion by the beard. But he said, I grabbed the lion by the beard and killed it. Let me say this, when you're serving God in the backwoods of life and nobody's around, that's where your faith grows. His faith was growing out there protecting those sheep. And so he would kill the lion and kill the bear. And so when he faced Goliath, it wasn't his first rodeo. God was growing his faith in the backwoods of his life. And when he got down there, it was just the next step. And he was so bold. When you're filled with the Spirit, you have a boldness. We can do this. And Goliath was taunting the army of Israel. He was taunting David. And David said, you come to me with a spear and a sword. I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts. And today, that by the fowl of the air will eat the army of the Philistines. I mean, those other soldiers had to be thinking, this guy is crazy. I know I've shared the story. I didn't share in the other two services. But when Zig Ziglar was reading the story of David and Goliath to his son, he had just got saved. He was 30-something years old, and he was reading Bible stories to his son, and he read the story of David and Goliath to his son. And his son looked up at him, at Zig Ziglar, and said, Dad, Goliath was really brave. And Zig said, well, let me read it again, son. Goliath was the giant. David was the little boy, and he read it again. He said, yeah, wasn't Goliath brave? And now they reverse roles. How many of you know we can learn a lot from children? And so he said, well, what do you mean, son? He said, well, Dad, Goliath was out there all by himself, and David was out there with God on his side. He said, that's right, son, you're right. I want to tell you, if God be for us, who can be against us? Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. One of the things you'll find with people filled with the Spirit, they have an unusual boldness in their life. And so he tells Saul, it's not a problem. And then we know the story. The Bible says that Goliath was approaching David. And as he was approaching David, I love when the Bible says David ran toward Goliath. He took a stone, put it in his sling, and with one stone it sunk into his forehead. And the Bible says Goliath fell face down to the earth. David didn't have any other weapons, so he went and pulled out Goliath's sword, cut his head off. When the Bible says when he did that, I'm just kind of paraphrasing, you read the story, the army of the Philistines said, we're in big trouble. And the Bible says they turned and began to flee. And when they began to flee, all of a sudden faith built in the army of Israel. Those cowards that had been up there on the hill, when they saw the other army fleeing, they began to shout, woo, and they began to chase them. Isn't that funny? Little Goliath, who was full of the Spirit of God, a man after God's own heart. And that day, God brought about a great victory through David. And this is the David that wrote the Psalms. By the way, after that, the women began to sing and dance. They said, Saul has slain his thousands, but David his 10,000s. Yeah, Saul's pretty awesome, but David, wow, that guy is amazing. And when Saul heard that, he was mad. He wanted to be top dog. And the Bible says he began to chase David. For 7 years or so, David lived in caves. And the Bible says that Saul picked 3,000 of his choicest men, and their only job was to kill David. How many of you would like to be chased by 3,000 of the choicest soldiers, and their only job was to kill you? And to help you understand, this, by the way, is the cave of En Gedi, which is actually in Israel, and it's in the area where his men hid out in these caves. And on two occasions, you remember, Saul came into the cave and he had a chance to kill Saul. And David's men said, yeah, this is it. God has delivered you. Kill him. And David said, I will not raise my hand against God's anointed. I don't know how he could be that patient. David waited at least 15 years. And many of the Psalms that David writes, I believe he was inspired by being a shepherd out there in the middle of nowhere, just out in nature. I believe many of the Psalms were written while he was being chased by Saul's men. When you read the Psalms that David wrote, he feels like he is surrounded by the enemy. That's why I think we can identify with the Psalms that David writes. He was a man after God's own heart, and so when you read the Psalms that David wrote, you're hearing really the heart of God. This just kind of gives you an idea how small Israel is compared to New York. It's really, really small. And when you have 3,000 men chasing you down for 7 years, it can be stressful. But I want to tell you, the Bible says that God's hand was on David and he was protected. And so David was 30 when he began to rule over Judah. I mentioned that. But he only got to rule over Judah for 7.5 years, and he was 37 when he finally got to rule over all of Israel. And he ruled for 40 years total. And so that information should be on your notes. Here's the one verse I want to kind of get as we come to the end. David says this in Psalms 27 when you say, what's the heartbeat of David? What drove David? What was his passion? How was he able to survive out there in the wilderness with the sheep? How was he able to survive being pursued by Saul? Listen to what he says. Let's read together out of Psalms 27 verse 4. One thing I have desired of the Lord, and that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. David said, one thing in life motivates me, and that's to behold the beauty of the Lord. His love for God and God's love for him is what drove him every day. This past Wednesday, we asked the adults who were here and the youth and the children, what one word comes to mind when you think of God? And these are some of the answers they gave. One word that comes to mind, and all these are good answers, by the way, no bad answers up there. But if we were to ask David, what's the one word that you think of when you think of God? I believe he would say, beautiful. You know, I'm just being honest. You know, growing up in church, I often saw God as a general or a boss. But I believe as we really, our heart draws near to God's heart, I believe we're going to see the beauty of the Lord. And so again, David says, the one thing I've desired, the one thing I really seek in life is to behold the beauty of the Lord. The last verse I want to share, or just thought, it's not really a verse. It's interesting that David, twice in the Psalms that he wrote, refers to himself as God's beloved. Here's what I want to end with. Not only did David behold the beauty of the Lord, but as he drew near to the heart of God, he realized how much God loved him. Can I tell you, many times we only see ourselves as an old sinner saved by grace. But I believe as you draw near the heart of God, you're going to be blown away by how much he loves you. As I was preparing this message, I was on YouTube and just looking up some things. And out of nowhere came this Keith Green song. And it's a song that goes perfectly with what we're talking about today. Keith Green, how many of you remember Keith Green? Some of you will remember him. He died on July 28th, 1982. They were having some family over at their house, and they had their own private plane that they would fly, and so they were going to go up that day. And he came in and said to his wife, you want to go flying? And she said, well, not today. And she said, you go with the kids, and I'll see you when you get back. And so he went up with two of his three children. His wife was pregnant with their fourth child. And also on the plane was another couple and their six children and one other person that worked with them in ministry. So there were 12 people on board the plane. It wasn't long after they left that Melody, his wife, got a call that the plane has come down. And she wasn't exactly sure what that meant, but when she got to the site, she realized the plane had wrecked. And there was a lot of smoldering going on. And so she was walking up to the plane that was crashed, as she tells in her own words. She says, as I was getting near the crash site, God seemed to say to me, stop. I don't think you want to see what's there. And so she said, I turned around and I walked away. That day, in that moment, she lost not only her husband, who was 28 years old, she lost two of her three children. And again, one couple and their six children and one other individual died that day. But if you know anything about Keith Green, if you were to ask me a modern-day prophet, he would be as close to it as I could get. Man, that guy was so passionate for Jesus. And one night, he just felt that his heart was becoming hard toward God. And he wrote a song, and the song is, Lord, I want to behold your beauty. Exactly what David was talking about. And some of us here today, our hearts have gotten a little hard. And sometimes we just need to behold the beauty of the Lord. And so I want to close with this. The first part of it will be Keith Green in his own words talking about God giving him the song. And then we're going to hear the song with the words on the screen. Feel free to sing along or just say the words. And I just want you to think about having a heart after God's.
On Monday night this week, about midnight, I wrote a letter to the Lord. I didn't know where to mail it, so I put it in my Bible. And I asked him, Lord, you got to do something about my heart. You know, a lot of time's gone by since I met you. And it's starting to harden up. You know, it's just kind of natural. I want to have baby skin, Lord. I want to have skin like a baby on my heart. It's starting to get old and wrinkled and calloused. It's not because of anything I'm doing. It's because of a lot of things I'm not doing. And I stayed up till about 2 in the morning writing this song.
fire that once burnt bright and clean. Replace the land of my first love that burns with holy fear.
You're here this week, and I know today you're going to go out and begin in the mission field that God's called you in. I want you to stand just for a minute. We want to acknowledge you. If you're here, part of the mission team, I want us to take a moment. Let's just pray. Let's just pray for them, can we, church family? Father, in Jesus' name, we pray for each one who is standing, who is here this week as a missionary for you. God, I pray that they would serve with a heart after you. Father, I pray that you would fill them with your Spirit and give them a boldness to serve and just to share Jesus. Father, may that river of life just spill out in all that they say and do and bring honor and glory to you. I want us all to stand together if we can. We're just going to have just a moment of invitation. I want you right where you are just to build an altar. I just want you to give your heart to God. If there's some things going on in your heart, I pray that you would not excuse them. And I pray that you would repent. Would you just gaze on the beauty of the Lord and just kind of build an altar and give your life to Him? If you want to raise a hand, bow your head. I just want us to just love on God just for a moment. I just pray that as we go through the book of Psalms, that God would teach us how to be worshipers, how we can worship in the back roads of our life. So take a moment just right where you are and build an altar. And would you just love on God and just gaze on His beauty? And I pray that God, you would feel God reach down and wrap His arms around you and just remind you how much He loves you. That you are beloved by God. No wonder David said, that's my passion. My one thing in life is just to gaze on the beauty of the Lord. May that be our heartbeat this week in our private worship. Father, fill each one here. Father, as we head out into the mission field, I pray that again, your Spirit would spill out in everything we say and do. Father, teach us how to be worshipers. Father, may everyone go out of here today with a pure heart in your sight. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's close with a song today.
Worthy of every song.